Thank you for the introduction. Hi, everyone. In this talk, I will define a new learning with errors problem, which is at least as hard as exponentially many polynomial learning with errors instances, and still allows public key encryption. I want to recall some basic stuff about lattice-based cryptography. Lattice-based cryptography relies on great parts on the use of two problems. Short integral solution, introduced by Itai in 96, and learning with errors, introduced by Regev They both enjoy reductions from worst case lattice problems, such as finding a short vector in a lattice, a short non-zero vector. And they also provide a lot of cryptographic applications, such as one-way functions, public key encryption, fully homomorphic encryption. However, the efficiency is not so good. They both have all the cryptographic constructions have two major drawbacks. Large keys and slow computations. In order to improve the efficiency, two new problems have been introduced, polynomial SIS and polynomial LWE. They both make use of the algebraic structure of a ring in order to increase the efficiency of the ring ZQ of X modulo F. They also enjoy reductions from some lattice problems, such as approx SVP. However, these lattice problems are now restricted to a special class of lattices, such as ideal lattices, some lattices which correspond to some ideals in number fields. And one may wonder why approx SVP restricted to this special class of lattices is as hard as approx SVP for general lattices. And in fact, it's not. Some recent works show that approx SVP could be easy for some polynomials F. There is a quantum polynomial time of Bias and Song to find the generator of a principal ideal in any number field. Later on, Kramer and his co-authors studied the case of cyclotomics of prime power index, and they gave a quantum polynomial time algorithm to find a short generator of a principal ideal. So they can even find a short one, not only some generator. By short, I mean short up to some 2 to the square root of n approximation factor. Later on, they show that we can solve approx SVP, in fact, for all the ideals, not necessarily principal, up to the same approximation factor. Progress have been done for the case of multi-quadratics. Bernstein and his co-authors show that we can find a short generator of a principal ideal in a multi-quadratic number field. So here you can see a comparison between the hardness of approx SVP for arbitrary lattices and for ideal lattices in cyclotomic fields of prime power index. As you can see, the best algorithm for finding a short vector in arbitrary lattices for an approximation factor of 2 to the square root n takes 2 to the square root n time, while the best algorithm for finding such a short vector in this special kind of lattices such as the ideal lattices, takes only polynomial time. So, yeah, the question which should we ask is what should be done? one idea. So we have evidence that approx SVP could be easy for some polynomials. In fact, is easy for some polynomials. One solution would be to start to look at other kind of polynomials, such as the polynomial suggested in N2 prime. Another solution would be to start to use problems which are probably as at least as hard as polynomial CIS or polynomial LWE for a wide class of polynomials. And in this talk, I'll focus on this second solution. The first step to study this, this solution was done by Lubashevsky. He proposed a new polynomial CIS problem, and he showed, which is closely related to the old one, and he showed that if we can solve this new problem, then we can solve many old polynomial CIS instances. Just to recall, for polynomial CIS, we are given k polynomials in ZQ of x modulo f, and we are asked to find the short, non-trivial solution for the equation sum of ai times zi equals 0 modulo f. For the new polynomial CIS problem, you are also asked to find a short non-trivial solution, but now you don't have you are not asked to reduce this equation modulo f. So this is the only difference between the two problems. The main result of his paper is that polynomial CIS, the old polynomial CIS, reduces to the new polynomial CIS for any polynomial of degree, of bounded degree. So the question now is, do we have an analog of this polynomial CIS for our the LWE case? And the answer is yes. In this paper, we introduce MPLWE by making use of the middle product of two polynomials. And we give a reduction from decision polynomial LWE to decision MPLWE for an exponential class of polynomials F. To compute the now I want to explain how do we compute the middle product of two polynomials. Suppose we have two polynomials, A of degree less than n and B of degree less than 2n minus 1. In order to compute their middle product, we just compute their usual product. This will be a polynomial of degree less than 3n minus 2. And we take the middle coefficients and create out of them a polynomial of degree n. In fact, we can take any middle coefficients, not necessarily n. You can better visualize this by using matrices. So the middle product of a polynomial A and B corresponds to the multiplication of a Toeplitz matrix related to A and the vector of coefficients of B, the reversed vector of coefficients of B. Using the middle product, we can now define a new distribution, which is similarly to the polynomial LWE distribution. So for the polynomial LWE distribution, we have a secret S, which is a polynomial in ZQ of X modulo F. We have a sample from this distribution is a pair of polynomials, A and B, where A is uniformly random in ZQ of X, and B is A times S plus some error modulo F. Similarly, we can define the middle product distribution, where we replace the product here by the usual product here by the middle product. We can now define the middle product problem We have to, for this, we have to, so the middle product problem asks you to distinguish with a non-negligible probability over the choice of S between the distribution I have described and the uniform distribution. So it's similarly defined to the polynomial LW problem. The main result of this paper is a reduction. We show that polynomial LWE reduces to this new problem I have described, MPLWE, for any monic polynomial F of degree n, whose free coefficients is the invertible modulo Q, and whose expansion factor is bounded. So you can see here that there is an increase in the error proportional to the dimension n and to the bound on the expansion factor. I will try now to give some intuition on this reduction, just the main idea. So what we have to do is to try to map a sample from the polynomial LWE instance to a sample of the MP distribution. We want to map uniform samples to uniform samples, and we want to map polynomial LWE samples to middle product LWE samples. As you may know, a sample the second component of a sample from the polynomial LWE distribution can be written in this way, where rot f of b is a matrix. On each line, on line number I, for example, I have the polynomial b times x to the I modulo f. So this is the usual rot matrix used in crypto. So now, if we take just the first column of rot of fb and of the second and of the rot f times a, rot of f a times rot of f s plus rot f e, if we want to take the first column, we can write the first column as a product of a matrix mf, which is closely related to the polynomial f, the product of this matrix times the coefficient vector of the polynomial b. Now we can decompose rot of a as a product of a Toeplitz matrix corresponding to a and rot f of 1. The new secret will be this product of matrices, and the new error will be this one. As you can see, this one may not be uniformly random, but we can easily randomize it. And as you can see, this error may depend somehow on f. So we have to, in order to finish the proof, we have to remove somehow the dependency of the error on the polynomial f. Now I will present an application of the middle product LWE. This is a crypto system, a public key encryption scheme inspired by the public key encryption of Regev. We take Q, an odd integer. For the key generation, the secret key is a uniformly generated polynomial of degree less than 2 n minus 1. For the public key, we generate many pairs of polynomials. Ai is chosen uniformly random here. and BI is the middle product of AI and S plus 2 times some error. In order to prove security, we need log Q such samples. If we want to encrypt, so suppose we want to encrypt a binary message, we have to generate some uniformly random elements, which are also binary, and the ciphertext corresponding to this new message is a pair of polynomials, where actually the message is embedded only in the second component. To decrypt, we subtract C1 middle product S from C2, we reduce modulo Q and modulo 2. So this is the encryption scheme. The correctness relies on this, let's say, associativity property of the middle product. And we can recover the message as soon as the error here is small enough. For the security, first, in order to prove security, we have to replace the public key with a truly uniform one, and then we can just rely on the MPLW assumption. In order to do this, we need to have the element 2 to be invertible modulo Q. For the second part of the security proof, we should prove that the view of the adversary doesn't review anything about the secret message. So this is we want to show that these elements are static. The distribution of these elements are statistically close to this distribution. Contrary to the original Regev scheme, this element here is not uniform anymore. You can see this because, for example, if all the elements AI, if for all the elements AI, we have that their smallest coefficient is 0, then the smallest coefficient of this polynomial will also be 0. And all the polynomials AI can have the smallest coefficient equal to 0 with very high probability for the choice of the parameters. So this element here is not uniform anymore. Still, since the message is only embedded in the second component of the ciphertext, we can still show using the generalized leftover hash lemma that these two distributions are statistically close. As open problems, one idea would be to build some other cryptographic primitives using this middle product problem. Another idea would be to start to better understand the link between a polynomial LWE and ring LWE. We know that they are the same only in the case of cyclotomics, for example, but if we could have a reduction from a ring LWE to polynomial LWE, if we had such a reduction, then we could rely the hardness of the new problem I have introduced on the hardness of ring LWE. And we know that there is a recent result of Peikert and his co-authors, which says that if we can solve decision ring LWE, then we can solve BDD. And this result works for every polynomial f, not necessarily for cyclotomics. Another open problem would be to give an algebraic interpretation, let's say, of the matrix equations we have played with. Thank you.